Thank you, Mark. We are continuing our studies in the book of Romans, and as I have been saying for the past few weeks, we're in that section in which Paul, who has been giving very significant doctrine all through this book from chapters 1 through 11, is now from chapter 12 on applying it, and so we're in the application aspect of the book, and we come into a particularly significant part of that application, I think, with the passage we look at this morning, which is chapter 14, verses 1 through 12, in which Paul deals with the issue of divisions, judging one another, being critical of one another, and how we are to deal with the differences that we have, because we all have differences. There's always significant differences with believers within the body of Christ. So he takes that up now, beginning with verse 1 of chapter 14. Now accept the one who is weak in faith, but not for the purpose of passing judgment on his opinions. One person has faith that he may eat all things, but he who is weak eats vegetables only. The one who eats is not to regard with contempt the one who does not eat, and the one who does not eat is not to judge the one who eats, for God has accepted him. Who are you to judge the servant of another? To his own master he stands or falls, and he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One person regards one day above another, another regards every day alike. Each person must be fully convinced in his own mind. He who observes the day observes it for the Lord, and he who eats does so for the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. And he who eats not, for the Lord does not eat, and gives thanks to God. For no one of us lives for himself, for not one of us lives for himself, and not one dies for himself. For if we live, we live for the Lord, or if we die, we die for the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. But you, why do you judge your brother? Or again, why do you regard your brother with contempt? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each one of us will give an account of himself to God. May the Lord bless this reading of his word and bless our time of studying it together. Let's bow in a word of prayer. With those who are similar to them and like-minded, that's where we feel comfortable. God does things differently. He is building his church with people unlike each other. Christ purchased with his blood some out of every tribe and tongue, people and nation. As a result, there is a great variety in the church. Christians are not clones, Leon Morris wrote. We all differ. And that's good, but while variety adds to the richness of the church, it also gives potential for divisions. It did in the church at Rome. Paul now speaks to that problem in a lengthy passage, really, that goes beyond what we're going to cover this morning, but from the beginning of chapter 14 through the middle of chapter 15. And in these verses, Paul gives advice on how people are to live with each other. He deals with the issues of judging one another and being critical of one another. And so he deals with this in the context of those who are united in their love for Christ, but divided over how to live for Christ. The church was divided along the lines of those that Paul calls the weak and the strong. He speaks of the weak in verse 1 of chapter 14, and then in verse 1 of chapter 15, he speaks of the strong. So those are the divisions here within the church. And it's not only a division that was in the church at Rome, it's a division that's in every church. Every vital, growing church has people with varying degrees of maturity and understanding. Some are weak for various reasons, and others are strong in their faith. Those whose faith is weak are those that Dr. Johnson, in his studies in Romans, described as Christians who fail to grasp the nature of justifying faith. That is, who fail to understand that nothing we do can affect our standing with Christ. That doesn't mean that nothing we do can affect the fellowship that we have with Christ, but nothing that we do can shake us from our security and our salvation in Christ. When Christians are not clear in their understanding of that, when they don't really understand justification, it affects their understanding of sanctification, how they live the Christian life. It affects their walk with the Lord. It affects their relationship with people. If we don't understand that at the moment of faith, the believer in Jesus Christ is fully and forever accepted by God and cannot be more accepted than he or she is when they believe initially, then that individual will spend his or her life trying to gain that acceptance and being frustrated in that very effort. And so often the weak feel that the need to do certain works or avoid certain activities in order to gain God's approval. The result is they don't exercise and enjoy their Christian liberty. The issue involved in this, the issues, I should say, do not involve issues of morality or sin. They have to do with cultural issues very, very often, and have been described in the past as being debatable things. Now, sin is not debatable. But this isn't dealing with moral issues. This is dealing with more what we call cultural issues, what we can call Christian taboos. In our day, they may concern things like tobacco, alcohol, entertainment. And I go back in my youth, and that's kind of the taboos that I recall. But they vary from place to place, and the list probably expands greatly beyond that. And what happens is a person's spiritual level with those kind of standards that we set is measured by how he or she conforms to these rules or these taboos. And that is what was going on in Rome between those that Paul calls the weak and those that he calls the strong. One group wanted to put the other under their rules. The other group ridiculed them for their rules and their lack of liberty, the lack of freedom. Now, no one understood Christian liberty as well as the Apostle Paul. F.F. Bruce wrote a book in which the title of it describes the Apostle Paul very well. The title is Paul, Apostle of the Heart Set Free. And that's certainly what he was. His heart was set free. He wasn't bound by the taboos of his day, the taboos and the rules that people invented in his time. He was free of that, and he wanted all Christians to be free of it. He wanted all Christians to enjoy their liberty. But Paul's solution in this passage, Paul's solution in addressing this problem to the Romans between the weak and the strong, was not to force freedom on the weak, nor was it to allow the weak to impose their rules on the strong. His counsel was to be accepting of each other. That's how the chapter begins. Now, accept the one who is weak in faith, but not for the purpose of passing judgment on his opinions. Paul doesn't identify the weak specifically, but as he develops the problem in the church, we get a good idea of who they were from the issues that concerned them. They had scruples about certain things. They had convictions about diet and days, which suggests that they were Jewish converts who'd grown up under the law and continued observing aspects of it. But there were likely also Gentiles that also had strong views on such things as diet. Some of the pagans lived ascetic lives, that is, lives of very strict self-denial. And sometimes the pagans would give up meat and eat only vegetables. And so the weak that Paul is dealing with here in the church at Rome most likely were Jewish Christians and maybe some Gentile converts out of paganism whose past practices still influence their present lives. That's not uncommon for one's past life to continue to have a strong influence on their present Christian life. And so the issue, again, was not justification by faith, but how we should live now that we have been justified. These weaker Christians believe that we should live according to certain ritual requirements of the Mosaic law. So their faith was weak because they didn't understand that they were no longer bound by those requirements. Others in the church didn't feel compelled to follow their diet or their schedule. They understood that Christ's coming put an end to the law and an end to its rituals. Their faith made them strong. Paul agreed with the strong. That was his position. But again, his solution here was not to force freedom on the weak or even to try to win them over to the correct position. His concern was unity in the church. And so he sought to bring the two factions together by counseling mutual acceptance. Accept the one who was weak in faith, he tells the strong. That means more than tolerate these people. Do what you can to get along with them. Just put up with these weak people. He's not saying that. Literally, the word accept means take to oneself. The same word is used in Philemon 17, where Paul instructs Philemon to accept his runaway slave Onesimus in the same way that he would accept the apostle himself. In other words, accept him as a brother. So the strong in Rome were to accept the weak as brothers and sisters, accept them into their fellowship as though they were accepting them into their home, accept them as equals. And by doing that, they would give place to the Holy Spirit to bring the weak along and give them maturity and understanding. I think that's a lesson for all of us in that. We so often don't give place for the Holy Spirit to work. We get impatient or we think we have the answer and we want to impose that rather than wait and give the Lord time to work in the hearts of His own people. He brings us along at different paces. He brings us along in different ways. And we're simply wait on the Holy Spirit. We can't do the Holy Spirit's work. Only the Holy Spirit can do that. He's the one who sanctifies. And so I think Paul is saying that. Give him opportunity to work in the lives of these weaker Christians, and he will do that. He will make them stand, as he says later in the passage. In verse 2, Paul cites one of the issues that was in dispute. One person, he writes, has faith that he may eat all things, but he who is weak eats vegetables only. The weak Christians, and we're speculating here, but they may have become vegetarians as a safeguard against non-kosher meat in pagan Rome. It may have been that these Jewish converts could not find in the marketplace in Rome meat that hadn't been sacrificed to an idol or whatever the case may be. And so they couldn't find meat that fit their standard And so, fearing that they would violate the kosher standard for diet, they ate only vegetables. They understood the strong, I should say, understood that was not a problem, and so the strong enjoyed their freedom. So you had people eating vegetables and others eating meat, and they had this kind of rivalry. And the strong could cite that they had the book of Mark at that time, or they understood what the Lord had done in Mark chapter 7, verse 19, that Jesus declared all foods clean. But some of those weaker believers had not yet understood that or come to that conviction. But in that kind of situation where people follow different spiritual rules of conduct and do so out of a genuine spiritual conviction, it's easy in such a situation for the two sides to clash. So Paul warns against that in verse 3. The strong who eats meat is not to have contempt for the weak person who doesn't, and the weak person is not to judge the one who does eat. Now, Paul knew that those who consider themselves to be strong in faith and enlightened about God's word might have a tendency to look down on the weak and to think them foolish in their practice. And he knew that the weak might consider themselves to be pious and pure for holding firmly to the rules that govern their lives and the structure of their life and their life of denial, in a sense. And they would judge the strong as being sinners or being inferior for not meeting their standards. So there's this conflict. Both attitudes, Paul is saying, are wrong. That concerns God because they contradict God's attitude. He has accepted both the weak and the strong, Paul states. So should we not accept one another as well? Now, at this point, maybe you're thinking, now, this is slightly interesting, or maybe not. This is a problem about interpreting the Bible on kosher diet from the first century in Rome, and really has little to do with my situation today. Arguing over meat, I have no problem. I don't know anyone who has a problem with that. Well, that may be so, but in principle, this does have everything to do with us. And I'll give you one example. I remember years ago, there were some people who were here, and they had some, this is a number of years ago, they had success with a diet for weight loss, and people noticed, and they were pleased with that, and they began to push this diet a bit. Now, not based on the Bible, they didn't do that, but still, they made an issue of it that the underlying theme was the people who wanted to live right, to do the right thing, would adopt that diet. And if you didn't, well, you really didn't care about living rightly, and you weren't so concerned about being healthy. And it wasn't an obvious thing, but you could see this polarization that was going on among people. It's very interesting how easily divisions occur in a church among people over trivial things. It happens over non-biblical issues. I've seen it, but you can imagine how much greater the divisions would be when one is arguing from the Bible. Well, this is the diet that we have in Leviticus. We should follow that. This is biblical. But we're free from the law. And so you can see the rivalry that was going on, and Paul is seeing that within the church at Rome, and he says, don't judge. Don't criticize. Christians can ostracize those whom God accepts. It's not our church. It's His church, and so we must receive all of those whom God receives. Well, Paul develops this point further in verse 4. He asks, who are you to judge the servant of another? And the point is, of course, Well, none of us is to judge the servant of another. A worker answers to his manager. He doesn't answer to other workers. He doesn't answer to us. And as Paul says, to his own master, he stands or falls. And that's true for the Christian. We answer to Christ over these debatable issues, not to critical Christians. It is him that we must please, not others. He determines whether our behavior is acceptable, not other people. God has accepted every believer in his Son, regardless of race, sex, maturity, or intelligence. He has done it. He has accepted us, not on the basis of our performance, not on the basis of works, not on the basis of our character, not on the basis of our background. He's accepted us solely and completely on the basis of Christ's person and work and what the Lord Jesus Christ did for us at the cross. So because God has accepted us, we are to accept others and do so on the same basis, that of grace, not works. It's only by the grace of God that we are what we are. And only that grace can change us. And only that grace and the work of the Holy Spirit can make us stand. That's God's work. It's not our work. It's God's work, and he does it well. Paul says of the Lord's servant, he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. And he will do that not by extra biblical rules that people might want to impose on people, and not by criticism that others might offer against them, but he will do that by his power as the Spirit of God works. Food, diet wasn't the only issue that divided the church in Rome. There was also a controversy over the Sabbath. Paul writes in verse 5, one person regards one day above another, another regards every day alike. Each person must be fully convinced in his own mind. Paul doesn't actually identify the one day that he speaks of here as the Sabbath, but that fits the context of dietary laws and Jewish ceremonies. In Galatians 4, verse 10, and Colossians chapter 2, and verse 16, Paul writes of Christians observing the days and season of the Jewish calendar and being judged by others regarding the observance of the Sabbath. That was a problem that we find in the early church and in the other letters that Paul wrote, and so it fits the context here. I think it fits the issue that Paul is dealing with. The one day above another was the Sabbath, which the week, the Jewish Christians who were still tied to the law were holding to. The strong, on the other hand, believed that every day was equally dedicated to God's service. That was Paul's position, by the way. Though he doesn't recommend it here. He doesn't push that on anyone. But the fact that he says each person must be fully convinced in his own mind indicates that he didn't believe that the Sabbath observance was binding on believers. Paul could not have said that if he believed that the church was under the Sabbath law, because observing that law, that Sabbath law under the law of Moses, was not a matter of conscience. Moses didn't leave that option open. It was the law, and one must obey the Sabbath, whether you wanted to or not. In fact, the evidence of that is found in that incident in Numbers 15 where a man was out gathering wood on the Sabbath and he's discovered and he's brought before Moses and the court, and they try him and convict him and stone him. That's how serious it was to not observe the Sabbath. So this is an issue that was not debatable. If the Sabbath was for the church, then that settled it. But the fact that Paul is saying each person must be fully convinced in his own mind, each person must follow his or her conviction as to whether you observe one day above another, every day alike, suggests very clearly that Paul was saying we're not under the Sabbath law. And I bring this up or develop this somewhat because this is an issue that is relevant for the church today, because there are many Christians who believe that Sunday is to be observed as the Sabbath. The Westminster Shorter Catechism, for example, which I hold in very high regard, refers to Sunday as the Christian Sabbath. That was the view of the English and American Puritans. And it's the view of many Reformed churches today. Other Christians believe that Sunday is a new institution. It is the Lord's Day with its own characteristics, and it's not governed by the rules of the Sabbath. But these different views have led to controversy in the church. Those who believe that Sunday is the Christian Sabbath lay down rules restricting activity, which can tend towards legalism. So eating out on Sunday or going to a baseball game or a movie is considered to be breaking the Sabbath. When I was growing up, this was kind of the rule of the house. Don't go to movies on Sunday. And don't mow the yard on Sunday, which I was glad for that rule. But so I'm familiar with this thinking. Sabbath breaking is a sin. So, and if we're under the rules of the Sabbath in regard to Sunday, then that's the case. And so there's sometimes conflict among believers today over that very issue. But I think there are good reasons for rejecting an identification of Sunday with the Sabbath. One is the fact that the Old Testament describes the Sabbath as a uniquely Jewish institution. In Exodus 31, verse 13 and verse 17, it's called a sign between God and Israel forever. So the Sabbath is described as an institution that was established with Israel only. There's no evidence it was observed by Gentiles or even by the patriarchs before the law was given on Mount Sinai. The Sabbath was for Israel. It's part of the law of the Old Covenant. It is a sign of the Old Covenant and God's covenant with Israel. And Paul has explained that we're no longer under that covenant, that the law is not binding for us. He's made that point very clearly in chapter 10. We are not under the Old Covenant, we're under the New Covenant, and it has new standards. Now, those standards include worship on Sunday, and there's nothing in the position which regards every day alike that encourages a relaxed attitude towards Sunday worship. We observe the Lord's Day, and we are not to be forsaking the assembling together. That's what the author of Hebrews told his readers in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, which may have been Christians in Rome. But that's an issue very much for today. It's so easy for people to take a casual attitude toward gathering together on Sunday. The author says, as is the practice of some. So there were some that were just not going to church on the Lord's Day, on Sunday. Now, there's nothing in this attitude, this belief that every day is held alike, that would suggest you can take a casual attitude toward worship on Sunday. But having said that, Sunday is not the Sabbath, and it's not governed by the rules of the Sabbath. Now, Paul could have argued that. Again, he could have tried to impose his interpretation on the situation, but he didn't do that. His purpose was not to take sides or rule on the Sabbath controversy. It was to promote peace and unity in the church. This was not a problem of mixing law and grace. The gospel was not at issue here. What was at issue was a difference over Christian conduct and practice. So Paul didn't forbid observing the Saturday as a day of rest. We are free from that, but being free from the law not only means free not to practice its ceremonies, but also free to observe them. Paul did that. He ate ham with Gentiles. He kept kosher with Jews. He did what was appropriate in the circumstance. He was free to do that because he was not under the law. Professor F.F. Bruce wrote of Paul, I like this statement, he said he was not even in bondage to his emancipation. He didn't feel he had to not observe the Sabbath or feel that he had to not eat, not follow kosher. He could keep it if he wanted to, if it was appropriate to do that, or not do those things if it was appropriate. That's part of maturity. It's knowing how to apply the principles of the Word of God that govern our conduct in the proper way. So Paul did not lay down a rule on this matter. He let the Roman Christians solve it in their own minds. It was a matter of conscience. They were to study and follow their own convictions. The real issue, as Paul explains in verse 6, whether it is observing days or observing diets, is serving the Lord. It's honoring Him in our conduct. It's being faithful to Him and being thankful to Him. He says that in verse 6. He who observes the day observes it for the Lord. And he who eats does it for the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. And he who eats not, for the Lord does not eat, and gives thanks to God. The person who observes the Sabbath or observes a special diet out of conviction that it honors the Lord should do that without being censored or criticized or ridiculed by the strong. And likewise, the weak should not judge the strong who eats all things and honors God and glorifies God in the way he or she eats by enjoying his or her freedom. They shouldn't be judged for doing that. The issue is, first, doing what we do for the Lord, for his honor and glory. And second, we can't be other people's judge in the matter. As Paul put it in verses 7 and 8, for not one of us lives for himself, and not one dies for himself. For if we live, we live for the Lord, or if we die for the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. In other words, Christ is our Lord, and Christians are his servants. This was the purpose of Christ's death and resurrection. Paul explains that in verse 9. For to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. As the Son of God, Christ has lordship over the whole creation. He created it all. He gives life to all of the creation. He gives life to every one of us. He gives life to everything that exists. But his death delivered multitudes from sin's awful penalty and power to give believers in him, to give his people a new relationship with him. Something beyond just our Creator. He's our Savior, and he has brought us into a living relationship. He's resurrected. He's alive. And he guides and protects his people, protects us every day, and promises to bring all of his people without fail to heaven at last, to bring us to a glorious end. He is Lord, Paul says, both of the dead and of the living. Death cannot separate us from him. Nothing can. He is Lord over us through time and eternity forever. And so it follows that we must live for him, not for those who judge us or those who look down on us. And we must respect his lordship over other Christians and not try to impose our opinions on them. That's what Paul is saying in all of this. So Paul asks in verse 10, why do you judge your brother? Or you again, why do you regard your brother with contempt? And I think we should underline that word brother in the statement. The fact that it is a brother who is being criticized shows how unnatural this judging is. How unnatural it is to engage in criticism. It divides a family. It sets brother against brother. This kind of judging causes a civil war within the church. We should be united in mutual concern, not battling one another. I made the observation at the beginning of our study that it seems true that people are naturally drawn to those who are similar to themselves and like-minded. As believers in Jesus Christ, the reality is we have no one more similar to ourselves in this world than fellow Christians. For all of our differences, and there are lots of differences among us, they are minor compared to the similarities we have. So family feuds are unnatural. And again, it's not our responsibility to judge the actions or question the stand of God's people. That authority belongs to God alone. For, Paul says, we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. Now that's an interesting statement, isn't it? I think people might read that who aren't all that familiar with this and say, judgment seat? What's that? I thought we were free from judgment. And of course we are. All the sins of all believers were judged in Christ at Calvary and removed as far as the east is from the west. This judgment that Paul speaks of here is different. It is a judgment in which believers will give an account of their lives before the Lord. Paul writes of the same thing in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 in verse 10. He writes, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad." Now, the Greek word that's used here in both of these texts, in Romans and in 2 Corinthians, for judgment seat is bema. Some of you have probably heard preachers speak of the bema seat of Christ in distinction to the great white throne judgment. Well, this word is used in Acts 18 of the place in Corinth where Paul was brought by an angry mob and made to face Roman justice for preaching the gospel. Well, that judgment seat stands today among the ruins of the city of Corinth. It's a large stone platform. In fact, it has a plaque on the front of it that has the Latin letters, bema, that you can read. But it has underneath it the Greek letters bema, so you know what the word is. That's called the bema, that judgment seat, and that's what Paul had in mind here. He wrote the book of Romans from the city of Corinth and must have had that image of that great stone judgment seat in his mind when he wrote this. But the judge that he thought about here was very different from the Roman ruler that he faced when he stood before Gallio. Christ will give us a perfect hearing as he reviews our lives and rewards our deeds. That will happen for every believer. And Paul adds proof to that from the scriptures where he quotes in verse 11, Isaiah 45 and verse 23. "For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me and every tongue shall give praise to God." That's what we'll all do. We will praise him as we bow before him someday. But finally, in verse 12, he draws a sobering summary and conclusion that none of us will be exempt from this. None of us will be exempt from this bema seat. "So then," he writes, "each one of us will give an account of himself to God." And as someone said, Paul's reminder is two-pronged because on the one hand it shows why it is wrong for believers to criticize one another. It's not we, but God who is the judge. On the other hand, the very fact of judgment reminds us that we will give an answer to the Lord for our behavior, whether good or bad, as Paul told the Corinthians. But we will have to give an account for our words, how we spoke to others. We will have to give an account for how we used our gifts, how we used our time, how we used our freedom if we're among the strong. Freedom is not a license for laziness or indulgence. Certainly, freedom is not for sin. It's not for criticism. It's for service to be used to God's glory. It is a sobering thing to think that we will someday give an account to Christ of how we lived our lives. It's also an encouraging thing because it is then that He will reward our service. It's then we hope to hear Him say to us, "Well done, good and faithful slave, enter into the joy of your master." That's something to strive for. That day may be close at hand. That was certainly to be the thought that these Roman Christians were to have, because just in the previous chapter, in chapter 13, Paul said, "The night is almost gone and the day is near." And because it is, he said, "Put on the Lord Jesus Christ." He may be coming soon. Put on Christ. Well, when we do that, when we put on Christ, we put off criticism. We put off judging and despising our brothers and sisters. We behave as Christ did, who, as Peter said, went about doing good and healing the sick. In other words, we're to be godly men and women, fair and kind toward others. I like the words of Bishop Mole. We are to be severe with self, but gentle with others. Well, may God enable us to be that. And if you're here without Christ, may He help you to know your need of Him, because there is another judgment coming. There is a judgment seat. It is the great white throne, and it issues an eternal punishment. But there's a way of escape. It's through Christ, who died for sinners. All who believe in Him are delivered from that judgment to come. They are justified at the moment of faith. They are declared righteous, innocent, forgiven, and accepted forever by God. If you've never done that, if you haven't believed, look to Him, trust in Him, and then, by God's grace, live a life of freedom and joy and service for Him. God help all of us to do that. Let's pray. Father, we do thank You for Your goodness to us. We thank You for the Lord Jesus Christ and all that He's done for us. And we're reminded from this text of who we are. We're different people. We all have differences within the body of Christ. Paul makes that point here. He makes it in other places in the book of 1 Corinthians, and reminds us that those differences are good, but those differences can result in divisions and disputes. If that's occurring here, let us put that aside and let us be united with one another. May we do that in Your grace. We thank You for that grace. We thank You for Christ and His death for us. It's in His name we pray. Amen.